see as his chief of staff, and also announced that he's bringing in Steve Bannon, who's highly controversial for the alt-right movement, as his chief strategist. What should these appointments tell us?
Well, I think you're right. Mr. Priebus is a conservative, well-experienced former chair of the Republican Party. I think the other appointment should get us very nervous.
Yeah.
Our job, look, all of you know that we have struggled with discrimination and racism and sexism and homophobia for hundreds of years, right? It's the history of this country. Yeah. What we did to the Native Americans is atrocious. Hopefully, we have made some progress in making this country a less discriminatory society. And I will be damned if we're going to go backwards and try dividing this country up again. We're going to bring our people together. We're not going backwards. We're going to tell Mr. Bannon and any other advisors, this country is not, we're not going to be turning on each other. We're going to be standing together in the wealthiest country in the history of the world to fight for a society and a government that works for all.
They have won three branches of government, right, and the Supreme Court will be conservative. What exact power does the left have anymore?
I don't call it the left. I call it the vast majority of the people.
Okay.
Overwhelmingly, right. Look. If you look at issue by issue,
yeah,
okay, vast majority of the American people want to raise the minimum wage to a living wage. Vast majority of the people know there's something wrong when we are the only major country on earth not to guarantee health care to all people as a right. You all know that? We're the only major country on earth. You got 28 million people, no health insurance. Many of you cannot afford health insurance because your deductibles and your co-payments are too high. We're the only country on earth. We pay more per capita.
Yes.
Drug companies are ripping us off. We have more income and wealth inequality. Rich get rich, almost everybody else gets poor. Most people don't think that that's good. And one of the reasons...
And yet, they voted for a man
yeah,
who is part of the problem.
Yes. And then the question then is, where was the Democratic Party? Has the Democratic Party been doing its job in telling working people in Iowa and in New York and in Wyoming, we're going to stand with you. We have the guts to take on Wall Street. We have the guts to take on the insurance companies and the drug companies and the fossil fuel companies. I don't think most people believe the Democratic Party has done that.
We've been talking a lot about why Hillary Clinton lost, and I think she lost because she didn't have a spokesperson like you for the cause. I said from the beginning, I'm a libertarian, I'm a center-right girl, but you need a spokesperson for the cause, and I said she should have stuck you on the ticket. That would have been the victory. That would have got those voters out. Statements he made that weren't justified in saying that that tilted the election. I argue that the fault lied with her and her inability to do outreach to the communities that were listening and waiting for her to do so. Where does the blame fall, in your opinion?
Well, you could look at politics in many, many ways. I think what the FBI did was unacceptable. They got involved in a presidential election in an unprecedented way, and I think that's wrong. I think that hurt Clinton. But I think your point is more to the point. It's not just one instance. Mm-hmm. You know, I like Hillary Clinton, and I knock my brains out to get her elected. But I think it is fair to say that the working class of this country did not believe that she was prepared to stand up and fight for them.
Mm-hmm. Even if her policies were. See, it's about what you say nowadays. It's not about what you do, because beat by beat, there's no question of what she has done, the service she's done for this country. And I get that people are upset and they're, you know, but a lot of disenfranchised people have been in this country for many, many years. And I don't recall any of them saying, oh, you know whose fault it is? It's them. And they're the murderers and the rapists. Oh, no, it's them. They're the folks that should be. This is a new thing. This is brand new.
And we will not accept that for one second.
Bernie,
we cannot accept that for one second.
Tell us about your new book, Our Revolution.
Well, the book does two things. You know, when I began the campaign, we were considered to be a fringe candidate. Nobody knew who I was. And we were taking on the entire political establishment and the media establishment, everybody else. And at the end of the campaign, we ended up winning 22 states, getting 14 million votes, and winning the vast majority of young people. So we came a long way in the campaign, and the book talks about that. But the second thing, the second half of the book says, you know what? As Americans, we're going to have to sit down and do a lot of study. We're going to have to answer some questions. And these are not 5-second sound bites. Mm-hmm. Why is the middle class declining for 40 years? Is it morally acceptable that the top 0.1% now owns as much wealth as the bottom 90%? Why are we the only major country on earth not to guarantee health care to all people? Why do we have more people in jail, disproportionately African American, Latino, and Native American, than any other country on earth?
Why? Right.
How do you address climate change?
We gotta go.
Yeah. You know how we do that? We get the book. We get the book. Senator Bernie Sanders, thank you. His new book, Revolution, A Future to Believe In, is on sale tomorrow everywhere where books are sold. And of course, we will be right back.